ability to move beyond fear. And I further quote, according to Greenleaf, it takes a dream, not what happens without a dream. And for something great to happen, there must be a dream. Behind every great achievement is a dreamer of great dreams. Much more than a dreamer is required to bring it to reality, but the dream must be there in the first place. And ladies and gentlemen, this is endorsed by Adama Barrow. Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of the Gambia, Mr. Adama Barrow, the Speaker, Honorable Speaker of the National Assembly, my Lord the Chief Justice, Honorable Cabinet Members here present, National Assembly Members here present, senior government officials, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to you all. Your Excellency, it is with a deep sense of humility I stand before you to make these opening remarks on the occasion of Your Excellency's first meeting with the senior government officials on the theme Reflection and Soul Searching for Inclusive National Development. Indeed, reflection and soul searching are at the heart of what I would dare call Trinity. For it is in Trinity we can charge the civil and public service to become creatively abrasive and innovatively dynamic, to transform the way the civil service reinvents itself for better service delivery. All senior government officials, we are tasked with improving service delivery for the Gambian people. For this, we need to make significant changes to how we work to establish efficiency, transparency, and accountability. We need to say what we do, and we do what we say. In local language, then what a dohbi. Your Excellency, we will start this process beginning with the Office of the President, as you have directed. I have instructed the senior management team at the State House to begin a comprehensive personal review to ensure that we are matching people's abilities to the tasks we are asking them to perform, and where necessary, improve their skills, where necessary to improve their skill sets to perform their jobs. We need people to have confidence to make intelligent, evidence-based decisions and not be afraid of making mistakes. Something I accept has not always been the case in the past. Change often brings uncertainty, and I want to assure you that if you do your job well, you will be supported by the Barrow administration. But with this comes a responsibility, and it is important for us all to understand that we will not abide and excuse evidence-based culture of passing blame or kicking the can in the long grass, as it were. A culture of being late for meetings, a culture of failure to deliver. I firmly believe that we as a country can converge to excellence, and I have no doubt we will give you support in making this happen. To ensure the Office of the President's roles and functions are understood within the office and across government, we are developing an OP strategic plan that will clearly articulate the mandate of the office and lay not a roadmap for implementing the necessary changes. Myself, the Secretary General, and the Secretary of the Cabinet, and other colleagues in my office will review our systems and processes to ensure that the State House itself is held to standards we are asking others to hold on to. We must re-examine the way we make decisions, the way we pass information, the way we use information technology, and the way we communicate what the government is doing to our ultimate masters, the Gambian people. In this, business cannot be as usual, says Adama Barrow. But ladies and gentlemen, even as we drive to improve the way we work, we must appreciate the urgency with which we need to deliver to the Gambian people. We will therefore be reviewing the broader goals of the National Development Plan against His Excellency's stated policy priority sectors to ensure alignment and coordination across government. We are only as strong as our weakest link. So don't think you have succeeded if you meet your specific targets whilst your colleagues or counterparts in other departments and agencies have not met theirs. We must ensure all our efforts are aligned and mutually supporting. We will succeed or fail together. We must show leadership, a leadership in which we create an alignment of strengths in order to make our weaknesses completely irrelevant. Your Excellency, ladies and gentlemen, whilst we have articulated broad objectives in the National Development Plan, the President wants us to see these narrowed down to specific projects with timelines and work plans that we'll be holding people accountable for. If you are tasked with building a school, training a cadre of nurses, or building a power station, the President is saying that be aware that we will be monitoring and supporting your progress from the day the decision is made to the project's completion. What we will not do, he says, we will not wait until the due date to find out whether our expectations will not be met. Continuous assessment and problem solving is a culture we need to embrace if we are to move our country forward at the pace of our people expect. Our upcoming donor conference, therefore, we should be aiming to provide well-articulated requests from each sector that our donor partners and investors can support. We will not be successful in getting support for projects that are uncosted or without a robust evidence base. As such, we need to do more work at our priority projects. We must and we will. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, the Gambian people are impatient, and we cannot afford to let them down. The President needs and expects and demands your support, and I have no doubt we will together reward his trust in our efforts in this new Gambia. And we will show that we can set this country on a trajectory that will allow us to achieve our development ambitions. Thank you very much for your time and attention, and God bless the Gambia, and God bless everyone present in this room. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brani. I think we've pointed out several key issues that we all have to bear in mind. At this point, I will call on Honorable Amagba to give us some inspirational remarks.
Mr. President, this is a moment, history in making. I think Gambians will recall, since we ushered into this change, we've never had the opportunity for you to address such an important gathering, a very important people that would have to be with us, work with us, for us to deliver the dividends of democracy. An important cream of our society, the men and women entrusted with huge responsibility in delivering your agenda. Therefore, it's a timely moment for you to meet them and discuss with them. When you raised the idea initially with me, and of course with most of my colleagues, we all felt it was an event that we must do now and cannot wait to do it. As Minister of Culture, I think it's important that some of our cultural values and norms and conventions are serious, geared towards achieving the objective of Mr. President and his government. But prior to that, I would like to get you back to a little bit of history. I will not politicize this gathering, although I'm a politician, but I would avoid that. But I will tell you that it is not by accident that this body of people are sitting before you here today. It is by divine intervention of Almighty Allah God. And I think it is important we reflect ourselves at all times and believe as Muslims and Christians, people who believe in God, that we accept that Almighty Allah decide, and when he decides, this one is fine. Last year by this time, Mr. President, this country was facing a difficult situation. We were at the attention of the world. But because of the prayers of many Gambians and people outside the Gambia who love this country so much, that God saved this country and used the impasse that we have to market the Gambia, which we agree positively, Mr. President. We are also lucky that we got a leader who have the heart to forgive, but he does not forget. I can assure you that he does not forget, but he forgives. We work as a team, collectively as ministers. We have our differences from time to time. You can understand that when seven parties are together, of course, ideology, the policy can always be different. As a group, we have been mature enough to make sure that our differences does not become our weakness. Instead, it has become our strength. Because when we sit together, we speak to each other the truth and nothing but the truth. And we have a leader who is very humble, who accepts advice, who listens to people, and who is not easily carried away by sentiments or the narration of an individual. And that's why when we took over, we never had any formal handing over as ministers. I don't think any of my colleagues here can tell you that somebody handed over to him or her as a cabinet minister. We use our experience, our know-how. With the help of some of you, we were able to get things done. But, Mr. President, the vision was, let's sack everybody, because everybody seems to be contaminated with the past. He said, no, we don't have to sack anyone. Let's give everybody an opportunity and see how we can transform this country and see how we can transform the civil service to make it a better one, because it's been battered so bad that people were not thinking themselves, they were not really allowed to function the way they were to function. And that's why some of you are here. We know some of you were part of the system in the past. We know even people who do guns who are going to defend the German regime in your midst here. We knew a lot more than you think that we know, who are worshiping the past regime. But Mr. President said, no. This country belongs to all of us. And that's why I believe that God did not make a mistake in making prayer. Ahmad Ba would have done a different thing what he did. I wouldn't have taken it. Because I know, no, let's be honest. Let's be honest here. I know some of you, what you have done to me personally, and using your offices. But because God says, I want to bring a different personality, they will be able to forgive but not forget what you have done and give an opportunity, and that's why God made him a president. Now we've reached a situation where he has to deliver and we have to deliver as part of history The dividends of democracy must be given to the Gambian people. We cannot do it alone, we have to do it together. And how do we do that? The Secretary General has clearly spelled out the agenda of Mr. President with the National Development Plan. And this National Development Plan is a plan that belongs to all of us when we are a party to it. Nobody can say I was not involved, or I was not informed, and or didn't partake in preparation and the formulation of this document. Therefore, it is important that we meet as a group and see how best we can work towards the actualization of this plan. But in the process, some habits must change. The Gambian deserve better. As the President said on Saturday at the Kairaba Hotel, to be in public service is a noble task. It's a task that you look for nobility. We cannot accept the corruption of the past. We cannot accept the practices of the past. We must project, act, behave in a better manner than what we had before, and that was the reason why Gambians voted for a change. I'll get you back to a little bit of history about a week or three, 4 days ago. I was on board a flight. Before I boarded the flight, I think there were almost 9 Gambians who came around me. They were so bitter, they were so angry. But they are happy because they felt this cabinet means that they can say at their portrait. Everybody's attention was on Amadou, because everybody who was boarding the flight came around me, started lamenting how badly they are treated at the airport by our officials. They said, even if I carry 4 mobile, 5 mobile, they take it away from me. We are humiliated in our own country. They sad us, they take our mobile, even some of them steal our mobiles. And these are Gambians who've gone outside, hustling, struggling. Now they want to come back every 3 months to see their families. There was a very old man who couldn't even walk from Angola. Somebody was supporting this old man. When that old man spoke, I was almost in tears. They said some of us now prefer landing in Dakar than landing in Banjul. And we felt that now we got our country back. We don't have jobs, we've gone outside to toil, we don't steal, we don't sell crop. We work in the fields, the farms in Spain, the tomato farm, they work there, they pay little, they earn, they gather it, they bring it home. And when they come to their own airport, they are humiliated. Few people are doing that at the expense of the whole nation. Why should we be doing that? And they have to ask us to pay 40 euro, 50 euro, and we never get a receipt. And I told that the Vice President, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, and myself addressed this issue at the beginning of the tourist season at the airport. Mr. President, this is affecting your government, affecting your image, affecting the image of the Gambia. It's an issue that needs immediate attention. Gambians cannot be treated as foreigners and be humiliated in this country. Look, we cannot look low upon these people because they are not wearing ties. Or probably they cannot speak English the way you speak it. But remember the millions and millions of dollars they are contributing to this economy. The remittance they are sending, how important these people are to our economy. Now you said you want to raise revenue, you're seizing 5 mobiles from somebody, 3 mobiles somebody, 10, 50. They have a room called 50 euro room. We thought that room was closed. It's open, the door is still there. Why should under Adama Barrow's government, this government of national unity, have 50 euro room at the airport? Tell me, we have no justification for that. And I must tell you, Mr. President, the police have improved greatly. I can assure you that the huge corruption you heard about before police doing that is not anymore. I think it's limited, Mr. President. We must also acknowledge that other government agencies, the issue of SIS arresting people is gone. We have two issues that we are faced with now. And that is the immigration profiling. Fulas, when you have a fair color, when your color is red, is whatever, you are arrested, you are considered a foreigner. In our own country, we are treated and segregated under the immigration. Mr. President, this has been discussed many a time. It needs to be addressed. Gambians being harassed at that airport, reduced to beggars, and running to this, Mr. President, is an issue we cannot wait for tomorrow to address it. And I think it is important. Somebody sent me a text message yesterday. He said, your officers at the airport will not concentrate. Even Jamaican pass, they will not see because they are looking for mobile sacking people in their back. I swear to the Holy Quran, it's in my mobile phone now. Somebody said it to me last night. He said this to me. He said, even the Jamaican pass, they will not see because they are looking at people's back to collect their mobiles and use it. Just to give you an example, how, and look, we should question even, well, how was it possible, really, for those people to pass and through and come, nobody noticed them, and they go to their with all the people who were there. These are issues we have to look in, inwards ourselves, and try to see where we can get things corrected. Look, what God has given you, you must get. Mr. President every day talks about how can he better your salaries, how can he better your services, how can he protect you, how can he make you to feel comfortable in your own responsibility. And you cannot do that when his own constituent, that the overall interest of the Gambian people, few are not doing the right thing. It's not going to help us under our culture, our traditions, our values that we are known for as a country. We must respect them. We must practice them so that people can feel that they are part of us. And it is important that you also become loyal to the system, loyal to the government. Yes, a system have come and a system have gone, but the Gambia remains, and the Gambia is more important than any one of us. We will soon be gone. We'll soon be history. 22 years now is like 2 weeks, 3 weeks is gone. Nobody talks about it. We will also go and leave you here, but what you do to your country is what matters at the end of the day. And at the end of the day, we'll all be buried down. And what we do is what we're going to find there. All these buildings, all these assets, we're going to leave them here. Let's reflect back and see how we can do what we can do for the good of our country. And deliver to the expectation of the Gambian people. They cannot wait. Look, I am frustrated. The president, all of us, maybe Omar Jallo, who's been in business, who's been in government, is not a businessman, understand. But all of us who are in business, we feel frustrated with government. Procedure that never ends. Issues that never come. You keep on waiting everywhere. The system is so interactive that it is taking us time to understand why it is happening. We want to be practical. We want things to move. We want to make a difference. And you are the one who can help us deliver that. And once you do that, be rest assured that what you want, you will get it. Let me give you an example. If you don't assume, some of you are complaining. Let me come to that. Then you are on business class, it's been taken away. Do you know what we have discovered? Spending officers, heads of organization, don't even know how a ticket is procured. How they buy an air ticket, they don't know. They have no idea. You just sit there, somebody bring you a ticket of $300,000, you go and board the plane. You don't know how that ticket is, how that ticket was obtained as a spending officer, principal officer. That is sad, it's happening. I don't want to mention name, but it's happening. You let people abuse the system because you fail in your responsibility. Not even following the procedure of PULA. Not trying to research to make sure you get the best available ticket for your minister or for yourself, the cheapest ticket with the best one you can get on business class, to save that money that you know that is public money. That money you're spending, somebody's at the hospital, cannot even get paracetamol. You are flying on a ticket over $100,000 and you abuse it. We have a responsible government that will say if you abuse it, we stop it. It's not the wish of cabinet. It's a collective decision. It is not our Sane's decision. As some of you are provocating, Amadou Sane cannot make that decision. It is not Barrow's decision. It's a collective responsibility. All of us agree to it, to do it, until such a time that you can learn to understand how you can save this money, how you can obtain this ticket, how you can borrow, have nothing against the civil service. No, any one of us here have anything against you. The fact of the matter is, you must deliver, and we must work together, and we have an agenda, and you must work towards that agenda. If you feel you don't want to change, you don't want to be with us, we have nothing against anybody. You are free, and we'll let you go. But if you want to be on board, we are ready to struggle it together, work it together, we all be part of history. At the end of the day, we have something to narrate when we are gone, when we are out. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I will call on the Permanent Secretary, Office of the President, Admin and Finance, Mr. Muhammad Lamin JT, to give us the overview on some of the issues in terms of our pledges as civil servants.
Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of the Gambia, Mr. Adama Barrow, Honorable Ministers, Your President, Your Lord the Chief Justice, Honorable Speaker of the National Assembly, colleague permanent secretaries, senior government officials here present, all other protocols duly and respectfully observed. Your Excellency, with your kind permission, may I hereby read out, in line with the wishes of the Honorable Secretary General and on his behalf, the official pledge to His Excellency the President of the Republic. In that regard, may I call on the civil servants to rise with me to read out the official pledge.
As employees of the government, we realize that our actions and behaviors must reflect the core values of the civil service and understand that they are significant to the success of government. We pledge to take responsibility of our actions and commit to perform our job efficiently and effectively to the highest standard of quality. We take this pledge to protect the environment and ensure the personal integrity of colleagues and the public. We pledge that if we default in providing quality behavior, which may be detrimental to the interests of government, it is not only your right, but your obligation to speak out and voice concern to the appropriate authority. We pledge to the President that we are committed, courteous, accountable, and believe in teamwork. We will report to work on time and do our work well and on time. We will handle all assets of government like our own. We will safeguard the resources of the government, such as money and other valuables. We will always deliver our promises to our colleagues and citizens. We will not abuse privileges given to us. And finally, we will always work as a team, no matter which part of government we are physically present. So help us God.
At this point, I'm sure we are all eager to hear from His Excellency, Mr. Adama Barrow, President of the Republic of the Gambia, to give us his message we need to take along as we go back to our offices. Your Excellency, sir.
Honorable Speaker of the National Assembly, Your Lordship the Chief Justice, Honorable Secretary General, Honorable Cabinet Ministers, National Assembly Members, Senior Government Officials, Members of the Media, Ladies and Gentlemen, good morning to you all. Mr. Secretary General, I think that was the typical Ahmad Ba. We have been saying it several times. Business cannot be as usual. If business continues to be as usual, then the purpose of the new Gambia will be defeated. We are not losers, we are winners, the Gambian people. We were able to defeat the dictator because we are united. And that spirit must continue. Let me welcome you all to the State House in Banyuni. This is a unique opportunity at high level to discuss the issues of concern. Each one of you play at both technical and management levels. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, indeed, it is an open secret that the public service itself became the first victim of the brutality of the first regime. This important institution has been generally politicized, abused and rendered irrelevant as most operational and strategic decisions were surrendered to the office of the president for one man to make them all. This coupled with great instability of tenure and the brain drain, the public service became largely non-responsive and low performing. Fundamentally, when people went to the polls on the 1st of December 2016 and voted in a new government, there were many transformative agenda items on the ballot, which translate into a social contract between the government and the people. The expectations were and are still very high and deserve to be managed and attended to. Through deliberate and specific programs and projects designed to provide dividends of democracy. This process requires commitment, hard work and sincerity by all, especially you as sector leaders. Our own part at the level of the executive, there is a huge political will to pursue the path of reform and restoration of past practices and not punishment. This is why my first administrative orders as president were all aimed at revamping and sanitizing the public service. This includes setting up a panel to orderly reinstate the officials who were wrongfully dismissed by the previous government. The congest the office of the president by reassigning institutions and line departments to the preview of the ministries where they rightfully belong, and effectively empower the sectors to be in charge of their mandates and be accountable for their actions. We have also revived terms of references for the appointment of regional governors and other key personnel to be non-partisan in their day-to-day administrative work. The Public Service Commission is now fully staffed and ready to discharge its oversight functions to ensure the application of due process across the service. At the level of the National Development Plan, 2018-2021 has now been validated and is ready for implementation. This plan, which carries the hopes and aspirations of the Gambian people, has fully embraced the manifesto and philosophy of the coalition 2016, as well as the priorities of individual ministries and line departments. In the public service, there are many well-articulated policies, strategies and plans that do not get implemented because of the mindset of the so-called implementation bottlenecks. This culture has no place in the new dispensation. As we set out to implement our new development blueprint, it cannot be business as usual. We need to understand that no progress can be made in developing our country if we continue to conduct business as usual. Change needs to happen, and it needs to happen now. Let us therefore take charge of our destiny and make this country a better place for generations to come. I know that most of you are experts in your own rights, and I also know that for the past 22 years, the complaint has been that you have not been given the space and the flexibility to apply your expertise to improve service delivery to the population. Under my administration, the artificial barrier to the application of human creativity and inspiration to service delivery has been completely removed. What we now have is a public service environment with a clear vision, and what that encourages critical thinking, collaboration, and positive engagement. In this new Gambia, therefore, we must put all hands on deck to restore the civil service back to its former glory. In this vein, it is important to give a bit of context to demonstrate the magnitude of the challenges we are faced with. As you are aware, our debt burden is currently unsustainable with a GDP ratio of 125%. This means a huge quantity of our revenue goes to servicing of our debt rather than investing in education, health or other social development projects. Beyond economic challenges, we are faced with a major energy crisis, poor road networks, and inadequate infrastructure. The potential of our agriculture subsector still remains largely untapped due to limited investment and the resultant use of primitive farming methods. These challenges, stiff as they may be, are by no means impossible to overcome. It is my fervent belief that together we can turn them into opportunities and transform this country with strong foundation for rapid socio-economic development. This, however, requires complete positive attitudinal transformation and professional discipline, as well as loyalty to the motherland. In order for this process to be meaningful, you all as public servants have been entrusted with a responsibility to perform a noble duty for the betterment of the lives of our citizens. The reforms will only be meaningful if the benefits are visible and felt by all Gambians, especially those at the grassroots level. We are faced with challenges, but we are willing to listen and learn to succeed. But we can't succeed without unity. Others can help us, but the ultimate responsibility lies with the Gambians. We all face challenges of uncertainties, but we have to be determined to set up and connect. Gambian experts have to take risks for the sake of the Gambia. We are united in our fight for freedom. Let us continue to be united to work for the development of our country. I call on Gambians with the expertise, knowledge and skills to reflect on how to contribute to the development of our country. We have to be fearless, take courage, faith and determination to succeed as a nation. Together we shall progress. Let us come together. We can learn from China. By opening up, they have been able to advance in less than 4 decades. Much more a small country like ours. Our size, location, sea, land give us advantage. We have to take the advantage. It is now or never. There is light at the end of the tunnel. Business can't be as usual. If business is as usual, then the purpose of the new Gambia will be defeated. I therefore urge you all to take the courage to be committed and loyal in order to realize our dream and vision of a better Gambia. A nation with a clear vision and a strong ethical and responsive public service. The realization of the vision is possible if all of us here dare to assert professional ethics in our daily interaction. In conclusion, I once again urge you to be steadfast in your duty as public servants who have the responsibility to instill the best practices in the implementation of our national development plan at all levels. There will be quarterly performance review starting this quarter. My expectation is that the sectors will report on the state of implementation of the national development plan to determine our performance. Along this line, the month of April will be dedicated to review the implementation of the national development plan, and all official travels will be curtailed to the minimum during this month. I assure you that I value each and every one of you, and I shall endeavor to harness the potential of everyone, wherever and whenever possible. The law shall be our foundation. This new Gambia requires everyone to be ready to give our best to our country. Let us love our country. Let us work for country. Let us take care of Gambia as if it's our own house. Build it nice. Keep it safe. Keep it comfortable and keep it clean. Certainly, if all of us begin to treat our country as if it is your own house, I am convinced that we will soon have a country that everyone will be proud of. This is your simple yardstick of patriotism. We surely can do it. Let us just do it. Believe me, the Gambia is back. I wish you all a happy and prosperous new year, and I thank you for your kind attention.
Observing for a year, assessing for a year, definitely should be a vantage point to see the vision for transformation. The role of each one of us as a technician or a manager is emphasized. We have to move from the past to manage the expectations of landings. With hard work and sincerity. Partisan issues should not reflect in our daily interactions with serving the Gambia. As experts, there is no more excuse. Is what they call it? Executive order. You are the experts. You should be the ones giving the advice. Then here is your opportunity. Let us turn our challenges to opportunities by taking responsibility. Let us work together. Let us unite to realize our vision and work for country. Work for country. Work for country.